Before I start, I'd like to share something with you as part of the prayer requests. I hired a new worker this week, and his name is Alex. I need you to keep him in prayer. His girlfriend, who is in Massachusetts, her name is Melissa. Both of them come from very hard backgrounds. From as children, Melissa's parents dedicated her to Satan. Alex has lived in foster care, orphanages, all his life up in the Bronx area. So there's a lot of demonic activity going on within their life, within their houses. Apparitions, things moving out of closets, things like that. So anyway, he's been in and out of jail all his life, prison. So kids, as I told you, the choices you make and follow you the rest of your life. Make good choices. Understand who God is. Remember, he's always with you. But pray for them. As God's given me this opportunity to witness to him, and he shares what I'm sharing with him, with her, just pray that God will touch their hearts.
Amen.
This morning, what I'd like to do is, Bob, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, because this is important. I want you guys that have been here for a while to think of what it was like the first Sabbath I came here. Pastor Kurt was the pastor. I came back to the church. Was not here long before he got up here and said, "This is my last Sabbath here." Ricky, do you remember that?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. I was here to help him, because the lay pastor program at that point is you worked under a pastor. And I had been out of the church for a couple of years, came back under that program, realized that program changed. But anyway, so Kurt retired. Before he retired, he asked me if I'd be interested in being the lay pastor here. I told him, "Well, who's the pastor?" So he told me what the program was and said I needed to talk with the ministerial secretary of the conference. And brothers and sisters, I'm going to be honest with you. I did not want to be a pastor here at this church. And there was reasons for that. The first Sabbath that I came, Bob, you were here. Ricky, I believe that you were here. I think there was 19 people who were here, and they said that was a good Sabbath. But Ricky, you remember this, that the average age of those people was really close to 80 or more. And do you remember Bob McMillan? Okay, Bob McMillan told me, because I was really close with Bob, I loved him, but he told me that a church of this demographic, you spend all your time doing hospital visits or funerals. Is that accurate?
Yeah.
Also, what I want you to think about is a church that has an average age of 80 and above, how long is it going to keep its doors open with that age? Just do the math. And so there was a lot of reasons why I did not want to be a part of this. But it got to that point in my life where I said to Jesus, "Whatever you want me to do and wherever you want me to go, that's what I'll do and that's where I'll go." And Jesus said, "Here you go." So I was okay being an assistant to a pastor. That was okay, but to actually be a pastor, told Kurt, "Dude, I don't think they're going to want me." But I said, "Listen, I will. If you set up this meeting, I'll go talk to this man, have an interview with him. If he says okay, then I'll take that as a sign from God that this is where he wants me to be." So needless to say, I had that meeting. That meeting went well. Thus, this was the position that opened. But those of you who were there from the beginning, I want you to remember what the church was like then and how many empty seats there were. I want you to realize that we had to pray that God would bring younger people into the church. And when I prayed and when we prayed for younger people, we were hoping for 50 and 60 year olds.
That's right.
Okay, right? Ricky, did God answer that prayer?
Amen.
All right? And so God answered that prayer, and then as time continued to go on, do you know how long I've been here? I forget how long I've been here sometimes. This is going on I've been here for 10 years. This is my 11th year, so it's a decade. Now, how many of you have been into a church where you've had the same pastor for 10 years? Okay, so this is a unique situation that God has definitely blessed, because this church, from where it was to where it is today, was a long-term project and mission that God had. So we needed younger people, and God sent us younger people, 50 and 60 year olds. Hey Bob, when you're 80, isn't a 60 year old kind of a younger person? You know, when you're 90, 60 year olds really young. So we stayed there. We continued to pray. Do you remember when we had Lester Pratt come the first time? Lester did an evangelistic series, and to get him here, you have to sign paperwork. Now, if you guys haven't realized, or if I haven't told you, I'm dyslexic. I hate paperwork, and I don't do paperwork really well. That's why I don't write out sermons, and that has always been a problem working under pastors, because they didn't want you to preach unless they knew exactly what you were going to say. You know what I'm saying? So I was always one of those roll of the dice things when they let me speak. Anyway, so to get Lester to come, you had to fill out all this paperwork. Well, I never filled it out. I called the conference and said, listen, can we get one? Did you fill out the paperwork? No, I didn't fill out the paperwork. But, you know, we really need to have somebody. And I was talking to the secretary at that time, and I knew her. I told her what my issue was with the paperwork. And Lester had an opening that he was supposed to be at one church, had an opening that came up. He did this two separate times. So he came the first time. We still have people that attend church today through that evangelistic series.
Amen.
Right? So that brought more people in. What I realized with this church is this church was what I called an incubator church. The people would come in, all of you, as I've told you through all these years, the membership here, you're a loving family. When people come in here, they feel that, they know that, and they like that. The problem is when we were getting families with children, there was no other children here, we'd keep them, we'd settle them, and then they go to Daytona. Right? Do you realize what our evangelistic effort for Daytona was? They should be thanking us over the years, okay? Young families, same thing. They come, they look, but there just wasn't a lot for that age group. So we realized we needed children, and we prayed to God. Did God answer our prayers?
Yes.
Listen, this is how God answered our prayers. We needed children. We prayed. This man, Lester Davis, you remember Lester? Came here, and him and his family started coming to church, and we had no children. Lester came in. How many children did he bring into this congregation? Okay? Boom! Does God answer prayer? What I want you to see is that every time we had a need, God answered that need. Do you realize at one point the majority of this church's budget was being paid by one family? One family. And that's how this church was surviving. And we were wondering when that ended, what was going to happen. Okay? That ended. Has God answered and has God blessed us?
Yes.
All right. So, turn with me in your Bibles to Psalm 77. As Ray read, and I'll reread it now. Psalm 77, verse 11. I will remember the works of the Lord. Surely I will remember your wonders of old. When you read that text, I want you to think of where we came from when I first started and what God has done. And let me tell you, brothers and sisters, this is all about what God has done. As I told you, I work 6 days a week. I come here and do this. This isn't no plan that the conference had. This isn't no plan that I got from them. This is what God has done, because every time there was a need, God answered that need. Amen?
Amen?
Every time we needed something or someone to fill a position, God brought that person in. Pray that we'd have more people that were more musically inclined. And sister, you are an answer. Direct answer to prayer.
Amen.
And so are you. And all the others, Max, Tara, this morning, again, whatever need we have had, God has answered. So as we continue to look at these verses, I want you to see what God has done for us here in New Smyrna. I will also meditate on all your work and talk of your deeds. Your way, O God, is where? In the sanctuary. Who is so great a God as our God? Now let's look real quick at Matthew chapter 16. Matthew 16. Verses 15 through 18. You guys should be familiar with this. Jesus and his disciples are walking. Jesus asked them, "Who do men say that I am?" Verse 14 says, "Some say John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah, one of the prophets." Verse 15, Jesus said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered and said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered and said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell itself shall not prevail against it." On what rock did Christ build his church? On the rock of Peter? Or on the rock that Jesus was the Son of the living God? So I bring you to this text to let you see that is this the Church of Christ here in New Smyrna? Has Christ blessed this church? Has Christ over the last decade worked in this church to bring it back from the gates of death? I don't say that lightly. Just like I said, do the math. Figure out the age of the people. Do the math. If you don't get people, they're younger. All this, what God has done, he has done for a purpose. This is where we came from. And this is where we are today. What is the purpose of the New Smyrna Beach Seventh-day Adventist Church today? What is our mission, and what is our vision, and what is our goal? And where would you like to be in the future? I bring all this to you. That's only 12:10. You guys do realize you read your bulletin that service goes at 12:30, right?
Amen.
Okay. I won't take too much longer. I just want you to see how God has led us in the past and where we are today. And what you need to realize as members of this church is that we are at a really good place, but we have to make some choices and decisions of where we're going to go into the future. God has blessed this church. He's prospered this church. He's brought a lot of new faces into this church. You're in a place where we're blessed by having visitors on a regular basis. Amen?
Amen.
You also need to realize that the Adventist Health Systems just acquired Burt Fish Hospital, which is now a Florida hospital. And that is, what, a mile away? Okay? Do you realize that opportunity that God has presented to this church? So as I said, there is decisions and choices that have to be made to take us where we are today to where we're going into the future. And I bring this to you to show you where God has blessed us and led us in the past, and asked you, as members of this church, where do you want to go from here? One of the things that I've always heard since I've been here is, we love our small church. Well, small churches are great, but small churches also run the risk of dying. But, small churches that have the DNA of mission and evangelism can continue to be a small church if they're willing to plant other churches.
Amen.
You like that, right?
Absolutely.
Deborah, you like that idea? Kyla? Okay.
When you said small churches have been listed, what do you mean?
That's a good question. That is a very good question.
I'm sorry.
No, that's a really good question. A small church, if they stay small, as your people get older, and you don't get new people to come in, the church gets smaller and smaller, and eventually it will close its doors. But a small church that is mission-minded, a small church that has in its DNA evangelism, can be a church planter that, when it gets to a certain point, would be willing to actually start another church. And if you put that mission DNA into that church, when they get to a certain point, they too can plant another church. And so instead of having some big, large congregation, you stay more to what the Adventist Church has been called to.
Amen.
To have congregations and churches in different areas so that the message is moved out. Because in the counsels that we've been given, it's not the best idea, and sometimes it can get dangerous to just have everything very large in one place.
Amen.
Okay? So, you need to realize as a church congregation that the only place we have room is where you're sitting right now. Because every other room and part of the building is at 100% capacity. And where we're at right now, if we had a potluck today, I don't know if you could fit everybody here in that little room back there. Right? So we sit you outside. So we are at a place where we have to decide where we're going to go from here. You can do nothing, and what you're seeing in growth will stop. And if you do nothing, you will go backwards. But if you have a vision and you have a clear goal of where you want to go into the future as a congregation, then as God has blessed you in the past, God will continue to bless you all the way into the future. But these are decisions that we as a church are going to have to discuss and are going to have to decide. So I cast this out to you today, because we're at that point. This is how God works. Your church board has been discussing this for quite a while, because we know that we have to do something. When I came, as I said, 19 people. Now, if you take that logbook back there, we're averaging 70.
Praise the Lord.
Only one on that
room. I'm a visitor. Amen. That sounds good. Like something's happening in 10 years.
So listen. So your church board has been discussing this because we see where we're going, and either we're going to make some choices or we're going to not do anything. But you also need to realize that opportunities have been presented before us, and that with any opportunity, either you seize the moment or the opportunity will pass. Okay? As I said, we have a hospital now that is a mile away from us, and the opportunity for evangelism through that is tremendous. But also the opportunity for partnered ministry is endless. I have a meeting with the CEO, his name is Ken, once a month for the hospital up there. He is going to be coming here May 6th, and that's going to be our first hospital Sabbath. What I'm wanting to do and what we've been discussing is I want to have a health fair that the hospital provides the resources and we provide the place to have it. Now, we're a small church, we're limited with our resources, is that right? But when we partner with the hospital, our resources now have grown exponentially. Did I say that word right? Kids, this is why you want to make good choices. Education is important. This is one of the opportunities that we have presented before us. And talking with Ken, this man's heart, the idea is, this is one of the things that he told me, that the hospital is not in the business of evangelism. They're in the business of healthcare, so they have to partner with a local church because the church is in the business of evangelism. And together, as I said, the opportunities that we have are a lot. And we have to decide what we're going to do as a church. Because with that opportunity, I've been trying to get Walter Castro, who is my boss at the conference, to at least talk to me because of what our situation is. We need to decide whether we expand this church. And to do that, you have to get their permission. To do that, they have to come and see what you have. So I've tried to get in touch with him for quite a while, but this man has churches from Tallahassee all the way down to Miami. He drives from Orlando to Miami once or twice a week. So trying to get in touch with him is tough. But again, this is one of the things I found out about being able to partner with the hospital. Ken, the CEO, asked me, do you mind if I call him? He called him and set up this meeting and had this, the next monthly meeting that we had, Walter and another man from the conference came. We talked with Ken, and then those men came here. And when they came here, this is the first time they'd ever been here. They had no idea what was going on here. I had explained to them where we were, where we are, and what do we do about going into the future? Because I have no idea. And Walter was just amazed. When I told him about what the community services does in that back room about feeding the hungry, the homeless, church members, they were shocked. I told him, this big room back here is filled with food. And they box it up and they give all those boxes away. He kept asking me, how many people you got here? What are you doing here? And I told him, when we started, where we're at now, and where we're at now, look at our sanctuary. And he told me, he goes, I'm going to speak to you raw here. He goes, you need to build a 500-seat congregation. Some of you have already heard this already because it's been out. Okay? And my mouth dropped open. And it's like, well, I don't know if we're ready for that. But these are things we have to talk about. But what I like is the idea of church planting. Now, Ray and Ricky both approached me and approached the board, giving that perspective. And I said, I didn't like that idea because I came from a church where we did that. And they started with a membership that was at 300, and they needed to break off. And they did. They planted a church, and there was a lot of headache with that. But it was because, not because of the church plant, it was because of the leadership, okay? And their hearts were in the right place.
Amen.
What I see here from just, this is my perspective, What I see here is that almost everyone that comes here likes that small church feel. How do you keep that and continue to grow? So, as I talk with the board, with Ricky, with Ray, to really pray about this for guidance, I'm going to tell you that Ray has never changed his mind about church planting, and Ricky the same way. So Walter, when he was here, told me that you need to come with me to Camp Kalakwa. I didn't know what he was talking about. I was hoping he'd forget about it. So that's why I wasn't here last weekend. Last weekend, the North American Division had their church planting and evangelism boot camp. So he asked me to go up there. I said, no, I don't want to go up there. But I did. And what they did is they wanted my testimony of what God's doing here. Because as what Walter Castro said, for a Caucasian church that had the age demographic that you started with to actually grow, that is unheard of in the Seventh-day Adventist church, especially in North America. That's sad.
It is sad.
But it's true. Okay? Growth is happening in other demographics, but in our demographic, they were just so amazed at what God has done here. And I wanted to make sure that when I spoke to these people, who were all the pastors, church planters, administrators from the North American Division, who's the president? Dan Jackson?
Wilson.
No, of the North American Division. Dan Jackson. He was there. Okay, so like I said, everyone was there. And I asked, well, are you sure you want me to speak to these people? Have you ever heard me speak? You sure?
Amen.
So, he wanted them to hear, because within the Spanish churches, within the Caribbean churches, there's a lot of growth. But the other churches, there's hardly any. And he said that there's a lot of people there that are starting to lose their faith in actually church planting. But if they're able to see that God is what God has done here. Okay? And I want you to look around today, because this is a small congregation compared to what we usually run. But look around. Is there more than 19 people here?
Yes.
Is there children here?
Yes.
Are we meeting our church budget?
Yes.
Are we at a point where I'm having to come to you and say, we need to do something about expanding? Has God blessed us?
Yes.
Has God led us?
Yes.
So, think about it. It's a whole seminar on church planting and evangelism. Ray, Ricky, both. Yeah, I talked to Ray about this a lot. That again, what he felt God calling him is that we should plant another church. And after leaving this seminar, I believe that that is something that would answer our prayers. We can continue to be that small church, but also a church that is mission-minded, what we're actually here for.
Amen.
You know what surprised these guys the most? That we're a conservative church. And we're growing. You understand what I'm saying? Do you really understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
What I told them is that, because what Walter wanted me also to do, and I told Walter when he came here, you need to tell the North American Division what the Lay Pastor Program can do. Because if you look, just look at the numbers, where there's a lay pastor-led church, the numbers go up. When you have an old church and they just keep switching pastors, those numbers are stagnant or going down. And the only reason for that is because, remember this church when you guys had regular pastors? Those guys were ready to retire, right? And that's who they kept saying, you guys, they were ready to retire. Or, you know, so they were at the end. But a lay-led church is going to be led by a guy, or it's going to be led by someone who actually has a job. And if the church wants to do something, they better learn to do it themselves. Right? Isn't that what the spirit of prophecy tells us the church should be?
Amen.
Do you understand? I saw this early on when I saw this model of the lay pastor program, where they actually took somebody like me and put you in as the pastor, that this is the closest thing you're going to get to a first century church. This is the closest thing you're going to get to what Ellen White gave counsel to for what the Adventist church should be. That you start a church, you raise that church up, you get the people to be able to take care of themselves, and you move on and do it again. And you keep replicating that. So that instead of talking about addition,